So, it doesn't happen very often, but we're ahead of time, which is very good. The next speaker is already here. So I just propose that then we move then to Gilles Stoke, and we can go to lunch earlier. Okay? Perfect. So I'm calling for the next chairperson, Myra. So now we are moving, so we're passing from the molecules to the musculoskeletal system. So then particularly then relevant for all the people, so doing then the multi-scale knee modeling hands-on, but also for the others. So think that all the results of what Gilles will show, so are a way then to downscale the mechanical cues that are very important for then the regulation of the genes that, for example, Francesco has shown, that probably would have a regulatory layer in what Natasha so has shown for many diseases and disorders. So this is a way then to translate these mechanical cues, so from human behavior, body motions, so captured high level with cameras, then down to the tissues, and then down to the cell, so to feed an entire field of medicine, which is rehabilitation medicine, that is very often driven by extremely subjective criteria. And so objectivization here is very necessary.
Okay, now I'm going to introduce our next speaker, Gilles Serrancoli. Gilles is an associate professor and Serra Hunter Fellow at University Politecnica de Catalunya. He's coordinating the Simulation and Movement Analysis Laboratory within the Department of Mechanical Engineering. And he did his bachelor degree in industrial engineering at UPC, and he specialized in mechanics in 2010. Then he did his master's in biomedical engineering in 2011. And later he obtained his PhD also in biomedical engineering in 2015. And well, also like he worked as a postdoc in KU Leuven in Belgium. And he did other research stays in University of Florida, Stanford University, and Northwestern University. Moreover, he was like in 2017, opening visiting scholar, and since 2020 he has been opening fellow. Well, his research interests are developing more efficient musculoskeletal simulations, enhancing their capabilities and improving like the computational speed. Moreover, he has contributed in developing like a smooth foot ground contact model and in speeding the musculoskeletal simulations with the use of automatic differentiation. Currently, he's focused on developing a mesh-based contact pressure model in order to incorporate the joint pressures within the decision criteria to predict movements. Moreover, he has been contributing by integrating biomechanical simulations into Mobity, which is a telerehabilitation system for people with mobility impairments. So now, Gilles, I give you this. Okay, so welcome, Gilles.
thank you very much for the interaction, and thank you very much also for the invitation, Jerome. I really appreciate it to be able to present here today our research. Perfect. So I will present the approach that we are following to run musculoskeletal simulations. And at the end of the presentation, specifically with the contact pressure model that we are developing for these simulations. Well, as everybody knows, there is a need to understand the movement and its causes, the relation between kinematics and dynamics to improve rehabilitation treatments, to predict the outcome of orthopedic surgeries, then also to improve the design of assistive devices.
I'm sorry, Gilles, I need to enter because we have a technical problem with Zoom.
Okay, no problem.
Screen sharing has frozen.
Oh.
So we just need to share the entire screen.
It seems good. Yeah, no problem. and now, yeah. So in order to in computational biomechanics, in order to study this relation, basically there are two main different approaches, no? Using musculoskeletal simulations or finite element analysis. Basically, using musculoskeletal simulations, we consider a chain of rigid bodies, basically a multi-body system, and typically driven by muscles, although sometimes they could be torque-driven as well. And if we model contact interaction between bodies, these are in, from a macro-scale view without considering deformable bodies. Thanks to this simplification, so without considering deformable bodies, we can go directly to the to simulate the full body kinematics and dynamics. In contrast, finite element analysis consider deformable bodies, including the constitutive tissue models, considering the geometry meshes with the, and typically these equations are imposed at the nodes of this mesh. And since this requires more computational time, normally when running finite element analysis is only with one join, no? And also the definition of boundary conditions is not straightforward and sometimes comes from musculoskeletal simulations. As mentioned, the musculoskeletal simulations with what we can obtain normally is only the contact range. So a moment, a vector, a force that is that has three components, no, a vector, and also a moment at the joint. So this will be the resultant contact range, the resultant information at the joint. Whereas in finite element analysis, usually we have the details of the joint contact pressure distribution around the joint. So here in the approach in the contact model that I will present, we want to incorporate the contact pressure model, enabling the computation of the distribution of contact pressures, but using a full body model in order to estimate kinematics and dynamics of the whole body, including the pressures. So generally speaking, the musculoskeletal simulations try to simultaneously estimate or predict kinematics of the full body, also muscle forces, considering a muscle model, passive forces, which will come from ligaments, for example, and external forces that in a human model, normally when walking is only, they are only ground reaction forces. And as I mentioned, so with this information, what we can obtain is the resultant contact range. So a vector, a force vector and a moment at the joint and nothing else. No? But we know that in order to study joint degeneration, it is important to have the knowledge of the joint pressures, no? In order to see if joint degeneration will appear or not. So first of all, let's go a bit deeper in what we have in this musculoskeletal simulations. No? About the kinematics, we want to estimate or predict the kinematics of the whole body. In the example that I will show, we have 34 degrees of freedom. And typically, we need to relate, we need to impose the equations of motion. And in this case, we obtain this information from the OpenSim API. We also have a muscle model where we consider, basically the muscle model is a smooth hill type muscle model. We consider the tendon as a nonlinear elastic component. And then for the muscle, we have a contractile element that basically has the activation part that it will be a value between 0 and 1. And some terms that provide information about the capacity of exerting force depending on the length of the muscle and the velocity of the muscle, the contraction velocity. And also we have a passive term that will be the one modeling the passive forces of the elements surrounding the fibers, no? The passive tissues on the muscle. Regarding the passive forces, we could model the ligaments as also passive elements. Here we do a simplification. Basically, we consider joint passive moments that will increase the moment when we are around the limits of this, beyond the limits of the usual range of motion. And then for the ground reaction forces, we develop a smooth foot ground contact model that is continuously differentiable. This means that at the transition between no contact to contact, this is continuously differentiable, as we will see later. We will see later its benefits. Regarding musculoskeletal simulations, we can divide them into tracking simulations or predictive simulations. Basically, in tracking simulations, we have experimental data that we want to track and for different purposes. No? It could be to estimate variables that are not measurable in vivo, like contact forces, muscle forces, or to personalize parameters of the model, like musculotendon properties, stiffness, or damping properties of a contact model. Then the predictive simulations is for another approach. Basically, here we don't have experimental data. We don't impose experimental data. We just impose some minimal constraints. For example, the initial and final state, and we want to predict the optimal movement. No, in this case, we predict kinematics and dynamics at the same time. And this could be for the purpose, for example, to study the strategy followed by the central nervous system to move, or to predict and analyze new optimal movements, also in collaboration with assistive devices, for example. And in both cases, we formulate these simulations using, solving optimization problems, as we will see now. Basically, we need to formulate an optimal control problem. And in order to do it, we discretize the variables into different time intervals. And here we have the states and controls. And for the states, we parameterize them with Lagrange polynomials. So we also consider some collocation points in between. The constraints will be imposed into these collocation points. And thanks to this parameterization, then the cost function and the state derivative can be approximated as a function of variables at the collocation points. So regarding either tracking simulations or predictive simulations, typically we have as states kinematic variables like coordinates and velocities, and muscle variables like normalized tendon force, sorry, or muscle activations. And as controls, we could have accelerations or also the derivative of tendon forces. And then regarding the parameters, it depends on the approach or the goal, no, of the simulation. But if we, for tracking simulations, we could have, for example, parameters, musculotendon parameters or contact model parameters, no, that we want to personalize for that subject. And for predictive simulations, typically we will not have these model parameters. Then the idea will be, okay, with this radically calibrated model, we want to predict a certain movement. But then probably a parameter to optimize will be the final time. No? If the goal is to predict the optimal movement to go from one point to another, and then probably the time could be an optimization parameter. There is also a difference in the cost function between both simulations. For the tracking simulation, simulations, then the cost function is basically an error, the tracking error between the experimental data and the model data. And in predictive simulations, as I mentioned, we don't have experimental data, we don't impose them. And usually, typically, this cost function represents the criteria followed by the central nervous system to move. And as constraints, in both cases, we have the path constraints. Basically, in our case, the equations of motion, because we use implicit dynamics. Also, dynamic and continuity constraints in order to impose continuity on the state variables and its derivatives, and also boundary constraints on the variables. So this becomes a very big nonlinear programming problem with a cost function to minimize and multiple constraints, typically thousands of constraints, no? Depending on the number of intervals that we have and the number of degrees of freedom that we have. We solve this in MATLAB using the libraries of Cassady. And also the equations of motion are called from the OpenSim API in C++ embedded in a DLL that we call from MATLAB. So Cassady uses IPOP, and then inside IPOP, it uses gradient-based optimizations to solve this optimal control problem. So since we are using gradient-based optimizations, it's important to take into account to provide derivatives efficiently, because at each iteration, we need to provide the Jacobian and Hessian information. So this requires the computation of derivatives thousands or millions of times. And this is why already 5 years ago, we introduced automatic differentiation tools in OpenSim. And we observed that using this method, the musculoskeletal simulations could be run even 20 times faster than using the traditional method that basically is using finite differences. And also, since we are using gradient-based optimization, we need to take into account to provide continuously differentiable models in order to avoid that the optimization is stuck somewhere into a discontinuity. Here, the idea is to present three examples of these musculoskeletal simulations that we have already developed. Some years ago, in collaboration with people from Leuven, that is where I did the postdoc, basically we calibrated subject exoskeleton contact parameters and also foot ground contact parameters to then predict the collaborative movement. In this case, we had, in order to calibrate the subject exoskeleton contact parameters, we had experimental data. And the results basically were that basically contact parameters do not have a significant impact on predicted movement. Here, it's very simple. We have the result of the prediction with the parameter models calibrated, and also in red, the prediction with the parameters perturbed a little bit. So the predicted movement, it was basically very similar. We observed that the forces at the contact, there were differences. So the impact was high. So this was just an example of the one application, no, of these musculoskeletal simulations. Then also in collaboration with people from Northwestern University, we calibrated a musculoskeletal model, in this case of a rat, where they had data of anesthetized rats where they electrostimulate one muscle at a time, one of these muscles, and then also recorded the movement. No? So the idea here was to calibrate the musculoskeletal parameter values that could reproduce the movement, no? That could predict the movement. Here, one of the message was that, okay, depending on the number of trials that we provide during the calibration, then the fiber damping changed. But we could see that this value stabilized when including more and more trials. So the more trials that we include, the accuracy was typically higher. And also the prediction of the movement was quite accurate. Also, together with people from Leuven, we could run predictive simulations studying different criteria to optimize the movement. And we were able to run these simulations in 30 minutes. And now we are with our contact model, we are running in less than 3 hours. This was three examples where we applied this approach. And now we would like to go to have the knowledge of the contact pressures, right? Because in the examples we were using just rigid bodies, so a chain of rigid bodies. I will explain the development of this knee contact pressure model. In this case, in order to do that, we applied to the knee, and we used experimental data from the knee grand challenge to predict in vivo knee contact forces. This data is available online. We had marker trajectories, ground reaction forces, EMG, and knee contact forces. In this case, it was an instrumented prosthesis, so we knew the medial and lateral contact forces. That is a unique case. And also, we had the geometry of the prosthesis. We use a full body open sim model with 34 degrees of freedom, driven by 94 muscles. Actually, these muscles were actuating the lower limbs, while for the upper limbs we had were actuated by Torx, and also included the knee prosthesis. So we formulate here a tracking simulation, a very big tracking simulation, where we optimize at the same time kinematics, so coordinates, velocities, and accelerations, the dynamics, so muscle activations, and also normalized tendon force and residual knee contact forces, and slight variables, so the derivatives of this dynamic data. And we also have these four types of constraints that I mentioned: continuity, dynamic, path, and boundary constraints. While the path constraints, as I mentioned, since we are using implicit dynamics, we have the equation of motion, and also we need to balance get the balance between the kinematics, the contribution of muscles, contact, and passive. So we impose these as constraints. And as a cost function in this case, we are running a tracking simulation, so minimizing the error between the kinematics, the experimental kinematics and the model kinematics, and also the knee contact forces, both lateral and medial, and ground reaction forces and inverse dynamics loads. And in this case, we minimize slack variables, also residual knee contact forces, and muscle activations in order to facilitate the muscle force shedding problem. So in what it consists, so what we did in this new smooth knee contact pressure model, we started from the CAD files, so CAD files, the STL files of the prosthesis, and we simplified a lot, but keeping the complexity of the geometry of the knee. Then what is the process? So before the simulation, before to start the simulation, we compute the potential contact pairs. So we had, in this case, the experimental movement. So what we did, we sweep the movement of the tibia with respect to the femur, and we identified all potential pairs between one face of the tibial component with all faces of the geometry for the femoral component. And this already decreased a lot the number of potential pairs. It decreased 90%, so we kept only 10% of the potential pairs. Then during the simulation, what we are doing so is this. First, we compute the penetration between two faces, one face of the tibial component and all faces of all potential faces of the femoral component. This is basically a collision detection algorithm that typically they are highly non-continuous. So here we try to do it in a continuously differentiable way. So let's imagine that we have one face of the tibia and one face of the femur. We will calculate the penetration in this way. We first calculate the distance between the centers of the faces, we project to the normal of the tibia, and then we change the sign and we have the penetration. Okay, so then we need to do this between one face of the tibia and all potential faces, and we calculate the maximum penetration. We do this using a smooth function. So instead of using the typical max function that will not be continuously differentiable, we use this expression. Then, with the maximum penetration, we compute the pressure values using an elastic foundation model. In this case, it considers a rigid body, that will be the bone, with a very thin elastic layer, that it could be the cartilage in natural knees, or in this case, it's super thin, for the prosthesis. We use this expression. And also in the way that is, since we have a smooth contact model, the penetration could be negative, so the pressure could be negative in this case. So we applied, again, another mathematical expression in order to smooth and lead the negative values to zero with this hyperbolic tangent. And then also we identified that we could have false positive pressures, like in this case, where if the femur during the simulation it will go in this weird position, we could detect positive pressures. Why? Because in this case this will be the projection, and this will create positive penetration, so positive pressure, while actually there is no contact. No? So in order to minimize this effect, what we did is mathematically identify this. So considering a plane of the face of the femur, then we project the normal of the tibia and we identify this projection is inside a circle surrounding the face of the femur. If it is not, then we assign that there is no contact. If it is inside, we will consider that there is contact. But we need to do it in a continuously and differentiable way. So we also use an hyperbolic tangent in order to achieve this. So at the end, the pressure value that we obtain for that phase, it will be the multiplication of the smooth pressure value with this multiplier that we obtain. And at the end of the iteration, then we sum, for each phase of the tibia, we could compute the force vector because we know the area. And also we know the direction. So we could sum all contact forces for all tibia phases. And then we can compute the resultant contact range that this is sent to the OpenSim API in order to compute the inverse dynamics loads at that particular time frame, no, for the tibia and to the femur in the opposite sign because they action-reaction. So with this we solve the simulation, and here are the simulation for the kinematics. In red is the simulated, in green is the experimental. They are quite similar, quite accurate, but we know that there is room for improvement for the kinematics. Regarding the tracking of knee contact forces, we are happy about them. We can see that the correlation coefficient during the whole, for the whole trial is quite good, quite close to one. And the root mean square errors are also quite low, comparable with other studies using the same data. And the residual forces at the knee were lower than 5 newtons in this case. Here is the data for the tracking of ground reaction forces, because we have the contact model between the foot and the ground, so we also compute them as a function of the kinematics, no? And we track the experimental data. So here in red is the model data. Overall, the tracking is quite good, although here for the vertical force for the right knee, could be a bit better, especially at the end of the stance phase. So it could be improved in this sense. Here I show the kinematics and the ground reaction forces, but what we can obtain here is also the values of the pressures at each time frame. And we develop a Blender framework, in order visualization framework in Blender, in order to observe the values of the pressures along time. Also, I didn't mention, the muscle model requires also the computation of the muscle tendon length at each call. No? Every time that we call it, we need to provide the muscle tendon length. If we call OpenSim every time, it will be computationally quite expensive. And in this case, we parameterize the muscle tendon length with polynomials. And actually, with this, we can also compute the moment arms, because it will be the derivative, the partial derivative of the muscle tendon length with respect to the coordinates. So this is done from some years ago, other researchers. But with this model, since we are opening all degrees of freedom of the knee, in total we have 6 degrees of freedom at the knee and 3 degrees of freedom for the hip with 3 rotations, then the verticular muscles between the hip and the knee will have a lot of polynomial terms, increasing the computational time to evaluate them. So what we are doing also is to reduce this number of polynomial coefficients in order to increase the speed of the simulation. So here are a summary of preliminary results. Basically, what we observe is that with this subject, the number of terms decreased around 30%, and the computational time to find an optimal solution at the end also decreased a lot, almost, 36%, no? So from 6 hours to 2 hours. So. We were happy about it. And And also here, in order to evaluate the impact of having this smooth collision detection algorithm, we did, for now, a very simple test using this smooth function to compute the penetration or without it, so using just simply the maximum function. So we obtain, in this case, we obtain a solution within 2,000 iterations and within a bit more than 2 hours using this smooth function, while with the regular maximum function, we don't obtain a convergence within 10,000 iterations, which is around more than 10 hours. So this means that with the smooth model, we obtain better convergence. So just to conclude, we obtain a smooth, we are developing a smooth pressure contact model that leads to accurate knee contact forces, kinematics, and ground correction forces simultaneously, although we know that there is room for improvement for the kinematics and ground correction forces. And if we don't use a smooth model, then we have issues with the convergence. We also observe that the initial guess of this gradient-based optimization is important. And we observe that if we pre-optimize the initial inferior-superior translation between the tibia and the femur, this led to lower initial cost function values, which in turn then it took a lower number of iterations to obtain the final solution. And also we applied for different gait trials, with similar conclusions. So the potential application of this model, so first we want to be sure that everything is consistent, no? Kinematics, ground correction forces, so all data analysis is dynamically consistent with the model. And then the idea is to study the generation of human joints, specifically to predict movements with this contact model included, no? Without using experimental data. And yeah, we need to also further investigation is needed in order to analyze the effect of geometry mesh refinement to see if a more accurate geometry will increase a lot the computational time, or also how the addition of tangential forces will impact the solution. So yeah, just to conclude, I would like to acknowledge the work of Joan Badia, Mohanad Harva, who are a master student and PhD candidate in our group. And let me also advertise a workshop that we will do in UPC here 1 kilometer from here at the end of September about predictive simulations of human movement. And in any case, I will be happy to answer questions if you have. So thank you very much.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Jill, for this interesting talk. If anyone has a question, like, or maybe I can start. Like, you mentioned that you reduced like the number of polynomials in, well, for the, I don't know in which part exactly, but how did you manage to reduce this? Because I don't know if you mentioned.
Yeah, I didn't mention how we reduced the number of polynomial terms. No, basically we use statistical methods in order, and those terms that are less statistically significant, we omit them, we neglect them. And the ones that are more statistically significant, we keep them into the function.
Okay, and also you... Okay, so another question that I have, you mentioned that there's room to improve like this, well, the results that you have.
So what would be the challenge and what would be the next steps to do this, like to improve?
Yeah, right now the parameters like the Young modulus and Poisson coefficients, we are not optimizing them. And it could be one option. And there, I presented briefly the contact model, but there are also some parameters related to the smoothing that mm-hmm. could affect the solution. And right now we are working also with this. Yeah, like kind of doing sensitivity analysis of these parameters.
Okay, thanks. Anyone has, Carlos. But, bueno, si quieres venir aquí o...
Okay, thank you, Yael, for the presentation. So I was wondering one thing. So basically, and I think it's really, really interesting job that to find actually the contact pressure that is one of the headache that we have in tissue modeling, indeed. But then I was wondering how sensitive your method to the number of nodes that you initially take in each of your surfaces, because they say, as I saw, well, maybe you improve that, but perhaps you show that your initial, let's say, mesh for the surfaces are quite coarse, let's say. Yeah, so how sensitive would be this? You know, maybe some improvement might be a refine more this.
In the last slide, I mentioned that we will need to do sensitivity analysis on how affect the refinement of the mesh. Yeah, that it could be also crucial. Yeah. We think that if we are able to reproduce the complexity, it should not affect a lot, but we need to do it, to test it.
Thank you. Okay, anyone else? Oh, all right.
Okay, let's test, yeah? Okay, perfect. Thank you for the presentation. It was really interesting. Maybe I missed something. I'm pretty sure you mentioned, but what kind of inputs do you use for the last application you showed for the processes when you predicted like the ground reaction force, kinematics, and so on?
In this case, we are simulating at the same time. Kinematics. Let's see. Yeah, I think that it was some slides ago. Yeah, here, no? We optimize at the same time kinematics, so coordinates, velocities, accelerations, and also the muscle activations, normalized tendon force, so basically the kinematics and dynamics. No? And then the ground reaction forces are computed based on the kinematics. So with this contact model with the spheres between the foot and the ground. And then as cost function, we track the kinematics and these ground reaction forces with experimental data. Okay. So we don't prescribe the kinematics. We optimize at the same time kinematics and dynamics.
And is there a main advantage? Because like the kinematics would be quite easy to collect with motion capture, for example.
Yeah, here we also we know that if we collect the kinematics and dynamics and ground reaction forces, we will never obtain a model that is 100% sure. No, we will always have a certain pelvis residuals. We call pelvis residuals because in OpenSim and also anybody consider these residuals at the pelvis, no? That it will be what is not, basically it will be the subtraction between, basically it's a representation of the error, no? Of the experimental error. So in this case, if allowing a small variation on the kinematics, then we can obtain models that are, well, models, so we can obtain kinematics and dynamics that are more dynamically consistent with the model that we have.
Ah, okay, got it. That, it really like the interplay between kinematics and dynamics makes more sense like this. Okay.
And the, actually, the goal of this having this contact model is to use it in predictive simulations. Right? And in predictive simulations, yeah, we are optimizing both kinematics and dynamics without tracking any experimental data. And then a model, a contact model that could provide pressures based on model kinematics would be essential.
Okay. That's totally fine. Maybe a second question regarding the contact model. I'm not sure, like in this application, you just use a contact model for a prosthesis, so it would be like the same for every patient. But when you would like to do predictive simulations for a health knee, for example, then you would need like a personalized mesh and geometries.
Yeah.
Would this be possible?
Yeah, good question. Obviously, we cannot have an instrumented prosthesis for or put a sensor pressure for all people, no? So we don't have this data. But basically, if we track, we run a tracking simulation with all data that we could obtain usually, no? The kinematics, the reaction forces, and EMG. And then we can run a tracking simulation and optimizing, for example, the elastic modulus of the contact and Poisson coefficient that could differ from patient to patient. No? And also, if we have the geometry of the knee, it will also be important here, no? Because it matters in this case.
Okay. So to summarize, like the main two parameters you would like to adjust would be like the stiffness and the geometry. Or are there any else, like any other parameters you would like to adjust?
Yeah, with this elastic foundation model, that actually with this framework, we could also change easily, no, the model relating the penetration with the pressure. But with this elastic foundation model, the main two parameters related to the contact are the Young modulus and the Poisson coefficient, that it could be optimized in this case. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much.
Okay, does anyone has more questions? Okay.
Yeah, thank you very much, Gilles. Thank you for coming and thank you for the very nice talk. I have three questions. I will go in order. My first question is, when you have then your contact model, so really in the knee joint, then the contact is, the localization of the contact is forced by the presence of the meniscus. So you don't have that.
Yeah, right,
okay?
Now.
And then you have a trick then to say, okay, so when when my knee goes off, so basically I mathematically then constrain my knee to come back. But also the 3D movement of the instantaneous rotation center is heavily then influenced by the meniscus. So whether your meniscus is healthy, whether your meniscus is not healthy, etc. So do you have a very specific then control on this instantaneous rotation center when you're doing then your anterior optimization in order to take into account that in this very specific patient, so my instantaneous rotation center moves that way because I assume that the meniscus has a certain function or a certain lack of function, and then you restrict your contact accordingly, or how are you coping with this?
Yeah, right now there is no constraint like this, but I don't see it very difficult to include it, no, because it at the end is a relation of the kinematics with the region of interest, no?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if, right now we don't have the meniscus, but it could be integrated. Actually, the elastic foundation model, as I mentioned, it considers that we have two rigid bodies with a thin elastic layer that it will be cartilage plus meniscus all together. No?
You might not need to have the meniscus. Huh? You might just have just a control on the instantaneous rotation center. So if you don't have meniscus, basically, you can have something like this. Mm-hmm. And if you have a meniscus, so basically, you have this nest
that represents the meniscus and then makes that your rotation center doesn't translate, your instantaneous rotation center doesn't translate that much.
And yeah, related to this, right now we have a passive elements that we model there, yeah, ligaments and everything that will be passive, no, is quite coarse now, but it could be improved, no, modeling a little bit more realistic what it happens. No, right now it's okay if we know that the knee is approaching to the limits, then the, there is a moment that it push back. No, it's what we have now that it will be kind of modeling this effect. No, but as a macro scale view, no?
Yeah.
Right now we have it like this.
Okay, thanks. And then the question I have maybe because I was changing the batteries when Carlos was asking, so maybe my question is redundant. If so, just ignore it. So when you're optimizing then the kinematics then together with the muscle forces, so actually. What you know better than I, that the synchronization among muscles so differs from people to people, so evolves with the development of pathology such as osteoarthritis. So I know that you have functions in order then to synchronize then the synergy among the different muscles. My question is, what is the least amount of data you need to do this exercise? What is the least amount, for example, of EMGs, etc., in order to personalize then the optimization of the muscles together with the kinematics?
Yeah, I think that currently what we can do in, let's say, a typical motion capture lab is with kinematics, compression forces, and an EMG, although the also, back in my PhD, we observed that the muscle parameter values affect a lot. And without the knowledge of knee contact forces, the forces that we can predict are a bit questionable without using a contact model. So yeah, we need to always take into account this. But yeah, of course, apart from ground reaction forces, kinematics and EMG, people also use ultrasound to have the length of the muscle. But then with this, you cannot track all muscles together and in a lab environment. So it's difficult.
But then sticking on the EMG, so what is the minimum of EMG recordings you would need in order to constrain correctly your muscle optimization? So
yeah,
only tight, then tight or back or?
Yeah, good question. At the end, what we can measure also is limited with the muscles that are more on the surface. Now there will be deep muscles that we cannot measure. I always used 8 muscles per leg as maximum, no? People use this number. But obviously, if we have more, it will be better, no? Mm-hmm. But then also, there is the effect of crosstalk for muscles that are deeper, that are confusing the signals, which is always difficult. So actually, there is no, it's still a research question, no? This topic, yeah.
Okay, and then so people who are doing hands-ons here and then motion captures are using the Helen Hayes marker protocol. Mm-hmm. So what kind of marker protocol then would be the ideal one in order to have then less residuals when you're doing then your optimization of the kinematics together with muscles?
Yeah, the end is always, I will not say that there is a unique protocol that works. So one size doesn't fit all, no? It says it depends on the goal. No, you can refer to a model that other people use it and they prove that they reduce the residuals, but there will be no protocol that will be 100% realistic, no?
Okay.
Yeah. This
Okay. Thanks, G.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, maybe I can ask you during the lunch because I have more questions. So thank you a lot, Jill, for this nice presentation.
Thank you very much.
And well, now this is the break for lunch, I think. No, you know?
We're ahead of time.
So I can ask?
Yeah, you can.
Okay. Yeah, following with Aurel's questions, like for me, maybe something is missing, but I don't completely understand the part where you are saying like you are tracking, but you are, I'm not understanding if you are using anything like as an initial state for the simulations. So I don't know if you can clarify this part a little bit better.
We are tracking the kinematics, ground reaction forces and knee contact forces. And as, initial guess, you mean?
Yeah, how do you start? How do you start the simulations?
In this simulation,
like a random state or?
Yeah, it could be a random state. Although actually we try different initial guesses in order to see how this affect the optimal solution. Although we know that if the initial guess is closer to what you expect for the optimal solution, is always it tends to be better. So the number of iterations that it will take the simulation, it will be lower. But one, running these simulations need to also be cautious because probably you end up having a local optima. So it's always important to start with different initial guesses.
Okay, so you start with?
I will recommend to start with, for example, for the kinematics, we can start with the data that we want to track, but this will generate contact forces that will be way off compared to the experimental data. No? And then for muscle activations, we could start from zero. No? And then this is one initial guess, and then we also built other initial guesses based on that one, just perturbing the parameters 5% or 10% with respect to the first initial guess. Yeah.
Okay. No, I understand very well. And also, I'm not sure if you mentioned this part, but you are doing these simulations like using C++. But I don't understand. Like you mentioned, like you are using the Elastic modulus and everything, but the characteristics of the person itself, because as Jerome also commented, like every person like is different. So do you use like the weight or like the length of the legs or something like this, like, or I don't know, the height?
Yeah, I didn't make emphasis on this, but the right leg, that is where the prosthesis is, we have the CAT, the data from CT scan or MRI, I should check now. But for the prosthesis, we have the STL file.
Okay.
And then for the other part of the body, we just scale it, following the regular OpenSim process with the mass of the subject, so that the total mass is consistent with the experimental subject.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Okay, so if anyone, I think I don't have more questions for now. So, thanks, Jill.
Okay. The idea is to present three examples of these musculoskeletal simulations that we have already developed. Some years ago in collaboration with people from Leuven, that is where I did the postdoc, basically we calibrated subject exoskeleton contact parameters and also foot-ground contact parameters to then predict the collaborative movement. In this case, we had, in order to calibrate the subject exoskeleton contact parameters, we had experimental data. The results basically were that basically contact parameters do not have a significant impact on predicted movement. Here, it's very simple. We have the result of the prediction with the parameter models calibrated, and also in red, the prediction with the parameters perturbed a little bit. So the predicted movement, it was basically very similar. But we observed that the forces at the contact, there were differences. So the impact was high. So this was just an example of the one application, no, of these musculoskeletal simulations. Then also in collaboration with people from Northwestern University, we calibrated the musculoskeletal model, in this case of a rat, where they had data of anesthetized rats where they electrostimulate one muscle at a time, one of these muscles, and then also recorded the movement. No? So the idea here was to calibrate the musculoskeletal parameter values that could reproduce the movement, no? That could predict the movement. Here, one of the messages was that, okay, depending on the number of trials that we provide during the calibration, then the fiber damping changed. But we could see that this value stabilized when including more and more trials. So the more trials that we include, the accuracy was typically higher. And also the prediction of the movement was quite accurate. Also, together with people from Leuven, we could run predictive simulations studying different criteria to optimize the movement. And we were able to run these simulations in 30 minutes. And now we are with our contact model, we are running in less than 3 hours. This was three examples where we applied this approach. And now we would like to go to have the knowledge of the contact pressures, right? Because in the examples we were using just rigid bodies, so a chain of rigid bodies. Here I will explain the development of this knee contact pressure model. In this case, in order to do that, we applied to the knee, and we used experimental data from the knee grand challenge to predict in vivo knee contact forces. This data is available online. We had marker trajectories, ground reaction forces, EMG, and knee contact forces. In this case, it was an instrumented prosthesis, so we knew the medial and lateral contact forces. That is a unique case. And also, we had the geometry of the prosthesis. We use a full body open C model with 34 degrees of freedom, driven by 94 muscles. Actually, these muscles were actuating the lower limbs, while for the upper limbs we had were actuated by Torx, and also included the knee prosthesis. So we formulate here a tracking simulation, no? A very big tracking simulation, where we optimize at the same time kinematics, so coordinates, velocities, and accelerations, the dynamics, so muscle activations, and also normalized tendon force and residual knee contact forces, and slight variables, so the derivatives of this dynamic data. And we also have these four types of constraints that I mentioned: continuity, dynamic, path, and boundary constraints. While the path constraints, as I mentioned, since we are using implicit dynamics, we have the equation of motion, and also we need to balance get the balance between the kinematics, the contribution of muscles, contact, and passive. So we impose these as constraints. And as a cost function in this case, we are running a tracking simulation, so minimizing the error between the kinematics, the experimental kinematics and the model kinematics, and also the knee contact forces, both lateral and medial, and ground reaction forces and inverse dynamics loads. And in this case, we minimize slack variables, also residual knee contact forces and muscle activations in order to facilitate the muscle force shedding problem. So in what it consists, so what we did, no, in this new smooth knee contact pressure model, we started from the CAD files, so CAD files, the STL files of the prosthesis, and we simplified a lot, no? But keeping the complexity of the geometry of the knee. Then what is the process? So before the simulation, before to start the simulation, we compute the potential contact pairs. So we had, in this case, the experimental movement. So what we did, okay, we sweep the movement of the tibia with respect to the femur, and we identified all potential pairs between one face of the tibial component with all faces of the geometry for the femoral component. And this already decreased a lot the number of potential pairs. It decreased 90%, so we kept only 10% of the potential pairs. Then, during the simulation, what we are doing so is this. First, we compute the penetration between two faces, one face of the tibial component and all faces of all potential faces of the femoral component. This is basically a collision detection algorithm that typically they are highly non-continuous. So here we try to do it in a continuously differentiable way. So let's imagine that we have one face of the tibia and one face of the femur. We will calculate the penetration in this way. We first calculate the distance between the centers of the faces, we project to the normal of the tibia, and then we change the sign and we have the penetration. Okay, so then we need to do this between one face of the tibia and all potential faces, and we calculate the maximum penetration. We do this using a smooth function. So instead of using the typical max function that will not be continuously differentiable, we use this expression. Then, with the maximum penetration, we compute the pressure values using an elastic foundation model. In this case, it considers a rigid body, that will be the bone, with a very thin elastic layer, that it could be the cartilage in natural knees, or in this case, it's super thin, no, for the prosthesis. We use this expression. And also in the way that is, since we have a smooth contact model, the penetration could be negative, so the pressure could be negative, no, in this case. So we applied, again, another mathematical expression in order to smooth and lead the negative values to zero with this hyperbolic tangent. And then also we identified that we could have false positive pressures, like in this case, no, where if the femur during the simulation it will go in this weird position, we could detect positive pressures. Why? Because in this case, this will be the projection, and this will create positive penetration, so positive pressure, while actually there is no contact. So in order to minimize this effect, what we did is mathematically identify this. So considering a plane of the face of the femur, then we project the normal of the tibia and we identify this projection is inside a circle surrounding the face of the femur. If it is not, then we assign that there is no contact. If it is inside, we will consider that there is contact. But we need to do it in a continuously and differentiable way. So we also use an hyperbolic tangent in order to achieve this. So at the end, the pressure value that we obtain for that phase, it will be the multiplication of the smooth pressure value with this multiplier that we obtain. And at the end of the iteration, then we sum, well, for each phase of the tibia, we could compute the force vector because we know the area. And also we know the direction. So we could sum all contact forces for all tibia phases. And then we can compute the resultant contact range that this is sent to the OpenSim API in order to compute the inverse dynamics loads at that particular time frame, no? For the tibia and to the femur in the opposite sign because they action-reaction. So yeah, with this we solve the simulation, and here are the simulation for the kinematics. In red is the simulated, in green is the experimental. They are quite similar, quite accurate, but we know that there is room for improvement for the kinematics. Regarding the tracking of knee contact forces, we are so far happy about them. We can see that the correlation coefficient during the whole, for the whole trial is quite good, quite close to one. And the root mean square errors are also quite low, comparable with other studies using the same data. And the residual forces at the knee were lower than 5 newtons in this case. Here is the data for the tracking of ground reaction forces, because we have the contact model between the foot and the ground, so we also compute them as a function of the kinematics, no? And we track the experimental data. So here in red is the model data. Overall, the tracking is quite good, although here for the vertical force for the right knee, could be a bit better, especially at the end of the stance phase. So it could be improved in this sense. Here I show the kinematics and the ground reaction forces, but what we can obtain here is also the values of the pressures at each time frame. And we develop a Blender framework, in order visualization framework in Blender, in order to observe the values of the pressures along time. Also, I didn't mention, but the muscle model requires also the computation of the muscle tendon length at each call. No? Every time that we call it, we need to provide the muscle tendon length. If we call OpenSim every time, it will be computationally quite expensive. And in this case, we parameterize the muscle tendon length with polynomials. And actually, with this, we can also compute the moment arms because it will be the derivative, the partial derivative of the muscle tendon length with respect to the coordinates. So this is done from some years ago, other researchers. But with this model, since we are opening all degrees of freedom of the knee, in total we have 6 degrees of freedom at the knee and 3 degrees of freedom for the hip with 3 rotations, then the verticular muscles between the hip and the knee will have a lot of polynomial terms, increasing the computational time to evaluate them. So what we are doing also is to reduce this number of polynomial coefficients in order to increase the speed of the simulation. So here are a summary of preliminary results. Basically, what we observe is that with this subject, the number of terms decreased around 30%, and the computational time to find an optimal solution at the end also decreased a lot, almost, well, 36%, no? So from 6 hours to 2 hours. So, yeah, we were happy about it. And also here, in order to evaluate the impact of having this smooth collision detection algorithm, we did, for now, a very simple test using this smooth function to compute the penetration or without it. So using just simply the maximum function. So we obtain, in this case, we obtain a solution within 2,000 iterations and within a bit more than 2 hours using this smooth function, while with the regular maximum function, we don't obtain a convergence within 10,000 iterations, which is around more than 10 hours. So this means that with the smooth model, we obtain better convergence. So just to conclude, we obtain a smooth, we are developing a smooth pressure contact model that leads to accurate knee contact forces, kinematics, and ground reaction forces simultaneously, although we know that there is room for improvement for the kinematics and ground reaction forces. And if we don't use a smooth model, then we have issues with the convergency. We also observe that the initial guess of this gradient-based optimization is important. And we observe that if we pre-optimize the initial inferior-superior translation between the tibia and the femur, this led to lower initial cost function values, which in turn then it took a lower number of iterations to obtain the final solution. And also we applied for different gait trials, with similar conclusions. So the potential application of this model, so first we want to be sure that everything is consistent, no? Kinematics, ground reaction forces, so all data analysis is dynamically consistent with the model. And then the idea is to study the generation of human joints, specifically to predict movements with this contact model included, no? Without using experimental data. And yeah, we need to also further investigation is needed in order to analyze the effect of geometry mesh refinement, to see if a more accurate geometry will increase a lot the computational time, or also how the addition of tangential forces will impact the solution. So yeah, just to conclude, I would like to acknowledge the work of Joan Badia, Mohanad Harva, who are a master's student and PhD candidate in our group. And let me also advertise a workshop that we will do in UPC here 1 kilometer from here at the end of September about predictive simulations of human movement. And in any case, I will be happy to answer questions if you have. So thank you very much.
Like you mentioned that you reduced like the number of polynomials in in which part exactly, but how did you manage to reduce this? Because I don't know if you mentioned.
Yeah, I didn't mention how we reduced the number of polynomial terms, no? Basically we use statistical methods in order and those terms that are less statistically significant, we omit them, we neglect them. And the ones that are more statistically significant, we keep them into the function.
Okay, and also you...
Yeah.
Okay. So another question that I have, you mentioned that there's room to improve like these, well, the results that you have. So what would be the challenge and what would be the next steps to do this, like to improve?
Yeah, right now the parameters like the Young modulus and Poisson coefficients, we are not optimizing them. And it could be one option. And there, I presented briefly the contact model, but there are also some parameters related to the smoothing that mm-hmm. could affect the solution. And right now we are working also with this, yeah, like kind of doing sensitivity analysis of these parameters.
Okay. Okay, thanks. Anyone has, okay, Carlos. But, bueno, si quieres venir aquí o...
Okay, thank you, Yael, for the presentation. So I was wondering one thing. So basically, and I think it's really, really interesting job that to find actually the contact pressure that is one of the headache that we have in tissue modeling, indeed. But then I was wondering how sensitive is your method to the number of nodes that you initially take in each of your surfaces? Because they say, as I saw, well, maybe you improve that, but perhaps you show that your initial, let's say, mesh for the, mm-hmm. the surfaces are quite coarse, let's say. Yeah, so how sensitive would be this? You know, maybe some improvement might be a refine more this.
Yeah, in the last slide I mentioned that we will need to do sensitivity analysis on how affect the refinement of the mesh. Yeah, that it could be also crucial. Yeah. We think that if we are able to reproduce the complexity, it should not affect a lot, but we need to do it, to test it.
Thank you. Okay, anyone else? Oh, all right.
Okay, let's test, yeah? Okay, perfect. Thank you for the presentation. It was really interesting. Maybe I missed something. I'm pretty sure you mentioned, but what kind of inputs do you use for the last application you showed for the processes when you predicted like the ground reaction force, kinematics, and so on?
In this case, we are simulating at the same time. Kinematics. Let's see. Yeah, I think that it was some slides ago. Yeah, here, no? We optimize at the same time kinematics, so coordinates, velocities, accelerations, and also the muscle activations, normalized tendon force, so basically the kinematics and dynamics. No? And then the ground reaction forces are computed based on the kinematics. So with this contact model with the spheres between the foot and the ground. And then as cost function, we track kinematics and these ground reaction forces with experimental data.
Okay.
So we don't prescribe the kinematics. We optimize at the same time kinematics and dynamics.
And is there a main advantage? Because like the kinematics would be quite easy to collect with motion capture, for example.
Yeah, here we also we know that if we collect the kinematics and dynamics and ground reaction forces, we will never obtain a model that is 100% sure. No, we will always have a certain pelvis residuals. We call pelvis residuals because in OpenSim and also anybody consider these residuals at the pelvis, no? That it will be what is not, basically it will be the subtraction between, basically it's a representation of the error, no? Of the experimental error. So in this case, if allowing a small variation on the kinematics, then we can obtain models that are, well, models, so we can obtain kinematics and dynamics that are more dynamically consistent with the model that we have.
Ah, okay, got it. That, yeah, it really, like the interplay between kinematics and yeah. dynamics makes more sense and like this. Okay.
And the, actually the goal of this, having this contact model is to use it in predictive simulations. And in predictive simulations, yeah, we are optimizing both kinematics and dynamics without tracking any experimental data. And then a model, a contact model that could provide pressures based on model kinematics would be yeah, essential.
Okay. Yeah, that's totally fine. Maybe a second question regarding the contact model. I'm not sure, like in this application, you just use a contact model for a prosthesis, so it would be like the same for every patient. But when you would like to do predictive simulations for a healthy knee, for example, then you would need like a personalized yeah, mesh and geometries.
Yeah.
Would this be possible?
Yeah, good question. And actually, obviously, we cannot have an instrumented prosthesis for or put a sensor pressure for all people, no? So we don't have this data. But basically, if we track, we run a tracking simulation with all data that we could obtain usually, no? The kinematics, the compression forces, and EMG. And then we can run a tracking simulation and optimizing, the, for example, the elastic modulus of the contact and Poisson coefficient that could differ from patient to patient. No? And also, if we have the geometry of the knee, it will also be important here, no? Because it matters in this case.
Okay, so to summarize, like the main two parameters you would like to adjust would be like the stiffness and the geometry. Or are there any else, like any other parameters you would
yeah,
like to adjust?
Yeah, with this elastic foundation model that actually with this framework, we could also change easily, no? The model relating the penetration with the pressure. But with this elastic foundation model, the main two parameters related to the contact are the Young modulus and the Poisson coefficient that it could be optimized in this case. Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Thank you so much.
Okay, okay. Does anyone has more questions? Okay.
Yeah. Yes, thank you very much, Gilles. Thank you for coming and thank you for the very nice talk. I have three questions. I will go in order. My first question is, when you have then your contact model, so really in the knee joint, then the contact is, the localization of the contact is forced by the presence of the meniscus. So you don't have that.
Yeah, right
okay,
now.
And then you have yeah. a trick then to say, okay, so when when my knee goes off, so basically, I mathematically then constrain my knee to come back, but also the 3D movement of the instantaneous rotation center is heavily then influenced by the meniscus. So whether your meniscus is healthy, whether your meniscus is not healthy, etc. So do you have a very specific then control on this instantaneous rotation center when you're doing then your anterior optimization in order to take into account that in this very specific patient, so my instantaneous rotation center moves that way because I assume that the meniscus has a certain function or a certain lack of function, and then you restrict your contact accordingly, or how are you coping with this?
Yeah, right now there is no constraint like this, but I don't see it very difficult to include it, mm. no? Because it at the end is a relation of the kinematics with the region of interest, no?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if. Yeah, right now we don't have the meniscus, but it could be integrated. Actually, the elastic foundation model, as I mentioned, it considers that we have two rigid bodies with a thin elastic layer, that it will be cartilage plus meniscus all together, no? Yeah,
you might not need to have the meniscus. Huh? You might just have just a control on the instantaneous rotation center. So if you don't have meniscus, basically, you can have something like this. Mm-hmm. And if you have a meniscus, so basically, you have this nest mm-hmm. that represents the meniscus and then makes that your rotation mm-hmm. center doesn't translate, your instantaneous rotation center doesn't translate that much.
And related to this, right now we have passive elements that we model there, ligaments and everything that will be passive, no, is quite coarse now. Mm-hmm. But it could be improved, no, modeling a little bit more realistic what it happens. No, right now it's okay if we know that the knee is approaching to the limits, then there is a moment that it push back. No, it's what we have now, that it will be kind of modeling this effect. No, but as a macro scale view. No, right now we have it like this.
Okay, thanks. And then the question I have, maybe because I was changing the batteries when Carlos was asking, so maybe my question is redundant. If so, just ignore it. So when you're optimizing then the kinematics then together with the muscle forces, so actually, what you know better than I, that the synchronization among muscles so differs from people to people, so evolves with the development of pathology such as osteoarthritis. So I know that you have functions in order then to synchronize then the synergy among the different muscles. My question is, what is the least amount of data you need to do this exercise? What is the least amount, for example, of EMGs, etc., in order to personalize then the optimization of the muscles together with the kinetics? With the kinematics?
Yeah, I think that currently what we can do in, let's say, a typical motion capture lab is with kinematics, compression forces, and EMG. Although, also back in my PhD, we observed that the muscle parameter values affect a lot. And without the knowledge of knee contact forces, the forces that we can predict are a bit questionable without using a contact model. We need to always take into account this. Mm-hmm. But of course, apart from ground reaction forces, kinematics and EMG, people also use ultrasound to have the length of the muscle. But then with this, you cannot track all muscles together and in a lab environment, so it's difficult.
But then sticking on the EMG, so what is the minimum
EMG
recordings
EMG,
you would need in order to constrain correctly your muscle optimization? So only tight, then tight or back, or?
Yeah, good question. At the end, what we can measure also is limited with the muscles that are more on the surface. No, there will be deep muscles that we cannot measure. I always used 8 muscles per leg as maximum. No, people use this number. But obviously, if we have more, it will be better. No? Mm-hmm. But then also, there is the effect of crosstalk for muscles that are deeper, that are confusing the signals, which is always difficult. So actually, there is no, it's still a research question, no? This topic, yeah.
Okay, and then so people who are doing hands-ons here and then motion captures are using the Helen Hayes marker protocol. Mm. So what kind of marker protocol then would be the ideal one in order to have then less residuals when you're doing then your optimization of the kinematics together with muscles?
Yeah, the end is always, I will not say that there is a unique protocol that works. So one size doesn't fit all, no? It says. It depends on the goal. No. Yeah, you can refer to a model that other people use it and they prove that they reduce the residuals, but there will be no protocol that will be 100% realistic, no? Okay. Yeah, this is...
Okay.
Okay, anyone else? Okay, maybe I can ask you during the lunch because I have more questions. So thank you a lot, Jill, for this nice presentation.
Thank you very much.
And well, now this is the break for lunch, I think, no? You know?
Well, yeah, we're ahead of time.
Ah, so I can ask?
Yeah, you can.
Okay. Yeah, following with Aurel's questions, like for me, maybe something is missing, but I don't completely understand the part where you are saying like you are tracking, but you are, I'm not understanding if you are using anything like as an initial state for the simulations. So I don't know if you can clarify this part a little bit better.
We are tracking the kinematics, ground reaction forces and knee contact forces. And as, initial guess, you mean?
Yeah, how do you start? How do you start the simulations?
In this simulation,
you put like a random state or?
Yeah, it could be a random state. Although actually we try different initial guesses in order to see how this affect the optimal solution. Although we know that if the initial guess is closer to what you expect for the optimal solution, is always it tends to be better. So the number of iterations that it will take the simulation, it will be lower. But one running these simulations need to also be cautious because probably you end up having a local optima. So it's always important to start with different initial guesses.
Okay, so you start with?
I will recommend to start with, for example, for the kinematics, we can start with the data that we want to track, but this will generate contact forces that will be way off compared to the experimental data. No? And then for muscle activations, we could start from zero. No? And then this is one initial guess, and then we also built other initial guesses based on that one, just perturbing the parameters 5% or 10% with respect to the first initial guess. Yeah.
Okay. No, I understand very well. And also, I'm not sure if you mentioned this part, but you are doing these simulations like using C++. But I don't understand. Like you mentioned, like you are using the elastic modulus and everything, but the characteristics of the person itself, because as Jerome also commented, like every person like is different. So do you use like the weight or like the length of the legs or something like this, like, or I don't know, the height?
Yeah, I didn't make emphasis on this, but the right leg, that is where the prosthesis is, we have the cut, the data from CT scan or MRI, I should check now. But for the prosthesis, we have the STL file.
Okay.
And then for the other part of the body, we just scale it, following the regular OpenSim process with the mass of the subject, so that the total mass is consistent with the experimental subject.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Okay, so if anyone, I think I don't have more questions for now. So, thanks, Jill.
Okay.